Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. So AI, everybody heard about AI. What is AI? Artificial intelligence. And I am so happy that so many people are here and you are natural intelligence. So I feel really happy to be surrounded by such a nice natural intelligence. So artificial intelligence is a very broad field. Actually, it is one of the broadest fields in computer science and one of the oldest fields of computer science. And artificial intelligence has many aspects, and it is not really well-defined. We don't really know what really intelligence is, but it is a common term now. But there's a workhorse of artificial intelligence, and this workhorse is called machine learning. And in machine learning, we design, we develop, we test, we evaluate algorithms which can learn from data and which extract knowledge and which can predict into the future. And this is very helpful for decision support systems, for decision making. And one particular family of these machine learning algorithms is called deep learning. And deep learning is at the moment and such a hype that we can speak from a deep learning pandemic. So everybody wants to apply deep learning. And what is deep learning? Deep learning is a class of machine learning algorithms inspired by natural neurons by the human brain. But technically, it is different. Technically, it is a network structure. And this network structure has many, many connections. And here a simplified example how this can learn. So at first, we need data. For example, data in form of images from cats and images from dogs. And our goal is to discriminate, determine a new image as cat or dog to classify. So this is a typical classification problem. And now we train this network, and it can beautifully learn to determine what is a cat, what is a dog. For example, even from previously completely unseen images. And this is taking place like that we look for pixels and pixels, and we can then say with a certain probability, for example here, 92%, this is a cat. But with the remaining 8%, this network says it's a dog. But 92% is quite a good performance. So this is state of the art. And apart from these cats and dogs, we use this, or we can use this in medicine, of course, in the health sciences. And a very good example, state of the art, is a very famous, highly cited paper from the Stanford Machine Learning Group around Sebastian Thrun. This is published in Nature. And they filled in dermatological images and discriminated either it is benign or malign. And if you see at the accuracy, at the results, it is 92% malign and 8% benign. And this is so a very good result. But the problem here is that you cannot go back, you cannot retrace, you cannot replicate this, and you cannot explain the underlying explanatory factors, how you get these results, how you get this 92% of this classification. So how works it technically? Technically, we have prior belief, for example. So we have a certain belief. We look at the cat. You look at the cat. You meet the cat. And you have a certain belief about this cat. We say the prior probability that it is a cat. And the more cats you see, for example, you see more cats, the more sure you have a certain concept learned of a cat with a very high likelihood. So this is the probability of the likelihood given the hypothesis that it is a cat. And now our computers, which I should now emphasize are digital computers, calculators, they can calculate very good. Humans cannot calculate that good, except my wife, because she's a mathematician. So we can learn the posterior probability, and the good thing is that digital computers can calculate that good. They can calculate fast. They can calculate in parallel, in very high-dimensional spaces, so much better than humans can do, and they bring out results like that. They are used at the moment in every corner and for every task. A typical task is recommendation systems. For example, you purchase a good, here for example, a circular glass cutter. So everybody knows what the circular glass cutter is. Glasrundschneider in German. Yeah. You purchase this good, you have it in your box, you purchase it, and then you get recommendations fully automatically, learned from the data, learned from previous purchases. And you get some recommendation. Maybe you should go with the three-hole insulin balaclava. So this is a typical example of machine learning state of the art. Here it is a very interesting result, a classification problem, again. And the task is to recognize and to interpret and to come up with an explanation for this image. And here we have a very high accuracy, 98%. It says, this is a horse on a meadow. Very interesting result. Humans can see there is a car. But now I show you what Explainable AI can do, which is really state of the art now. Now we have several methods where we can look up why this classification result came up with a horse on a meadow. And if we look at this, we see highlighted here as a red area in the corner below. And then if we have a closer look, it says Pferdefotoarchiv. And this was the reason, this was the cause for the result of the classification problem. So you see, this is a very, very good first step to get insight into the question of why. Because often, and particularly in medicine, the question of why is often more important than the result itself. And this is exactly what we want to do, and humans can do this very good because humans are able to use abstract concepts. So concept learning is one of our goals, to understand how humans learn, how humans get out so much from so little data. And therefore, we have built, we have designed, we have developed, we have now ready for the open international machine learning community an evaluation, explanation environment for concept learning of both humans and AI. And this is called Kandinsky patterns, and this you should remember from this talk, hashtag Kandinsky patterns. This is the giveaway, this is the gimmick. Yeah, and we have learned from pathologists. Pathology is a very, very interesting medical specialty, and pathologists explain and interpret geometric objects, geometric structures. They even speak from architectures. And they see some round-shaped objects, color-shaped objects, similarity. And they interpret and explain. And then they came up with their diagnosis. And we have replicated such a thing, but in a strictly controlled environment, where we have strictly controllable, mathematically strictly controllable conditions. So we can produce true images, for example, where we know the ground truth, but we can reveal the ground truth from the community, for example, and they can test the algorithms. This is kind of an intelligence test for algorithms. And then we can validate it and see what was the outcome in terms of explanation. The interesting part is we can produce with our Kandinsky generator false patterns, which can produce completely false results, but also counterfactuals, close. This is very difficult for both humans and machines to find out something of these counterfactuals. So this is an explanation environment where we try to answer the question, how do humans explain and how can we use it for artificial intelligence, for machine learning? Most of all, they use concepts. So concept learning is behind of this. For example, here color, shape, or quantity as a concept example. And we have even a booklet ready for this, so we can test, for example, also in without any computers. And this is the gimmick I have promised to bring with me. So this is the Kandinsky booklet, and hashtag Kandinsky patterns is the environment, so you can look it up and can test yourself, and you can compare it then to algorithms. So we have done several experiments so far as an IQ test for machines, particularly as an explanatory environment for testing causability and causality research. So causality is a very important field, particularly for the medical domain. And causability we have developed as a measurement so that we can quantify how good an explanation is. And obviously it is good if you understood it. So then the explanation is good, and the very important point is the very important point is to answer the question, why are 92% true and 8% false? So we have created a patho challenge where we have a completely environment ready for pathological tasks in a strictly controlled environment, open to the international research community, and the task, for example, are explain Kandinsky patterns algorithmically. That means training a network which classifies Kandinsky figures. These are the little ones you can see here, according to the ground truth. And I emphasize it is very important to have a ground truth, because if there is a visitor from Mars, we have to provide an explanatory framework for a mutual understanding. And this, we need the ground truth. This is very, very important. And this is most often not the case in machine learning, in the machine learning field. And the second task, just as an example, is explain Kandinsky patterns in natural languages, in natural language, so that a human can understand it. And this is very important for medical professionals, because they have somehow to transport their results into a meaningful natural language expression, which is then called the report. Yeah, and causability is to provide these underlying explanatory factors of why these 92% are true or the 8% are false, to answer these questions. Yeah, and we are working on this field, and our grand goal is to provide future human AI interfaces which can explain, which are able to explain why AI came up with the decision, this is the 92.8% and so on. So to provide an answer to the why question and to give some underlying explanatory factors. And this is a very important task for the future, to keep the human in control. This is our grand goal. Thank you very much.